Show the world. Let them know it's Halloween. Hit it!
Halloween Ends is directed by David Gordon Green and stars Jamie Lee Curtis as Laurie Strode and tells the story after the events of Halloween Kills, where Michael Myers has now disappeared after that fateful Halloween night 40 years later from the first film. Now everyone in Haddonfield is completely traumatized by the return of Michael Myers, even though he hasn't been seen around. The town is clearly in distress, and not everyone is doing that well. And then some killings start happening, some occurrences start happening, and something is going on in Haddonfield. It might not be completely Michael Myers' fault. Now, guys, I am going to be real with you. When I love the first Halloween movie. It's my favorite horror movie of all time. I enjoyed some of the sequels, though there are some that I like more than others. But overall, I had to say, there's rarely a movie in this franchise that I could genuinely hate. There's some that I don't like, but I never go as far apart from Halloween Resurrections to say that I hate the movie. And it's still not to this day, even after Halloween Ends. Still, Halloween Resurrections is the only one that I hate. Halloween Ends, it created a different area of itself. Like how Halloween 3 created its own little unique area in itself. I feel like this is going to be a cult movie in the future. Like, people are going to get into it a whole lot for the entertainment factor. And after watching it, I gotta say, I don't know how to feel about this. I really, really don't. Let's start with things that I do love. For one, the directing and cinematography, for the most part, is all pretty good. I wouldn't say it's as striking as the first two in David Gordon Green's trilogy, but for the most part, I'd say that it is still shot pretty well and has really good production value. The character Laurie Strode feels the most human here. Jamie Lee Curtis is giving her all in this performance, and she felt like an actual human being instead of a speech machine 24/7 like in the previous film. So did most of the other characters. Like, a lot of them felt like real humans. Corey, in the first part of his arc, was a really good character that I was really getting into. And what they do with him was quite interesting, and I'll get into that later. The daughter, Allison, played by Andy McNess. I'm sorry if I butchered her name. She did a pretty good job. The music was cool. Michael, when he's on screen, is cool. And then it turned into Romeo and Juliet and Suicide Squad mixed into one. And I was both lost, entertained, and angry all at the same time. I was crying of laughter, but not for the right reasons. This movie, in its second act, lost its mind. And I don't know how to describe it. It's like a completely different editor just came and just added a bunch of new stuff that wasn't built up from the previous two films. And I don't know. It mostly has to do with the Corey character in that last act. You know what? At this point on, guys, I'm just going to be spoiling the movie. There's no way I can talk about this movie correctly without spoilers. So, if you don't want to know spoilers, this is your time to get out. Spoiler warning, that's your warning. Corey becomes Michael's accomplice. And that's because Michael, when he first caught Corey near the beginning in his sewer lair, he sees the evil inside him and decides to let him live. And then later on, Corey returns to bring some guy that he hates to Michael. And Michael teaches him how to stab, and then teaches him a few tricks on how to be the boogeyman. It's like Michael Myers is Slender Man, and Corey is like a proxy of the Slender Man. And both of them have a weird relationship where it seems like Michael is trying to pass the torch on to a newer generation. And Corey starts to develop a relationship with Allison, Lori's daughter. And it comes so out of left field. First scene they are together, she's just throwing her panties at him and she wants to sleep with him immediately. It's like, this is some Twilight levels of storytelling right here. And Lori Strode is like in a different movie that's like a drama, and Corey and Allison are in a twisted version of Romeo and Juliet, and Michael Myers is just sitting there waiting for his scenes to come because this is a Halloween movie and he wrote a contract that he's supposed to appear in all these movies. It's like, I don't know. It's not well constructed. It is just multiple ideas just being thrown at the screen to see what sticks. And somehow I found it entertaining. It's like, how I never had this feeling like this since I watched the original Suicide Squad movie by David Ayer. It's like, it's a editing nightmare. I am so curious if there's a different version of the film. I swear there is a different cut of this film out there. One that's more cohesive and one that makes more sense. Because whatever this version is, it felt like I was being trolled in the second act. I literally felt like I was being trolled. I'm going to be honest. It was a movie. Okay. So all in all, the kills are fun. The horror element and Halloween element are fun. The movie is fun. I don't know, guys. I literally don't know. This movie is something. This is one of those movies that Jeremy Johns better give his good time if you're drunk. Because I swear, if you're drunk or high, you are going to have a blast with Halloween Ends. So I had a good time with it, and because of that, I'm going to give Halloween Ends a B-. But just rest assured, this is not how the franchise should have ended. as a Halloween movie, this is awful, but in terms of entertainment value, I can't lie, I had a good time. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please leave a like, subscribe, comment, and this is probably the worst review I've ever done, and I'll see you guys next time.